Okay, if you will, take your Bibles and turn with me to Jeremiah chapter, let's start with chapter 6. And let's look at one verse to begin with, Jeremiah chapter 6. And go down to verse 15, if you will. Jeremiah said, were they ashamed when they had committed abomination? No. They were not at all ashamed, neither could they blush. Therefore they shall fall among them that fall at the time that I visit them. They shall be cast down, saith the Lord. It's always amazed me, the book of Jeremiah, how it relates to our day. Because the nation had basically what had happened to the nation of Israel, we have saw the decay in our nation. And so we kind of stand at the same point in our history that the Jewish nation stood in the prophet's time. And he deals with judgment. He told them, there's going to come an enemy from the north. You don't know their language. They're strangers to you. And they're going to put hooks in your nose, and they're going to lead you away to a foreign land. 70 years later, the prophecy came true. The Babylonians came in, took them over, and carried away the what we call the Babylonian caravan. They had got to the point, the people of Jeremiah's day, that they were not embarrassed about anything. He said, you got to the point to where you can't won't even blush. So this morning I want to talk to you on the subject of vanishing blushes. Nothing embarrassed them. They were not shocked by anything. Bats Hellner said this, there was a time when we sinned and were embarrassed. That's so embarrassed that we blush. Now we are embarrassed because we blush. And that about having summed it all up for us, didn't it? Well, that introduction, now turn the page over to chapter 5 and verse 1. Let's start reading there, and let's look at the first 5 verses. Run to and fro through the streets of Jerusalem, and see now and know that seek in the broad place wherein, if you can find the man, if there is any that executed judgment, that seeketh the truth, and I will pardon it. And though they say the Lord liveth, surely they swear falsely. O Lord, are not thine eyes upon the truth? Thou hast stricken them, but they have not grieved. Thou hast consumed them, but they have refused to receive correction. They have made their faces harder than a rock, and they have refused to return. Therefore, I say surely, these are poor, they are foolish, for they know not the ways of the Lord, nor the judgment of God. I will go unto the great men, and I will speak unto them, for they have known the ways of the Lord, and the judgment of their God. But these have also altogether broken the yoke and gone astray, and broken the bonds and gone astray. So the prophet said, well, wait a minute, maybe I'm surveying the wrong folks here. I'm talking to these folks that are poor and maybe don't know any better. Maybe they don't know how you're supposed to act, what you're supposed to do. So I'm going to go to the cream of the crop. I'm going to go to the leaders. I'm going to go to the spiritual leaders and the national leaders. When he got there, he said, my goodness, they're worse than the others. Something had happened. How do people get at the level that Jeremiah predicted, visualized his people being? I believe there's two things that causes that. First of all, there are corrupt powers. Whatever is at the head of the country trickles down. And whatever they are, eventually the nation will slowly but surely become. corrupt powers. Four things about these leaders. First of all, in verse 5, the Bible said they were informed scripturally. Look again, if you will, at verse 5. And I will give them a great... Well, wait a minute. Let me get verse 5. Verse 5. Verse 5 talks about how they knew the Word of God. They knew about God. They knew the Word of God. And so they were sinning against, if you will, being informed scripturally, but yet they did not do what they knew to do. Now, isn't that about where we're at today? I mean, about everybody in the world ought to know as much Bible preaching as they are, or at least preaching as they are going on all over the country, the news media, the social media, local churches like we are. You think that people would just simply know the right thing to do. But it said they had another problem. They were inflated with substance. In verse 7, he said, I fed them to the full. I fed them to the full. We live in the most prosperous time in all history. Never been a time in history when the United States was as prosperous as it is now. Prosperous as it is now. Most of us don't worry about what we're going to eat tonight or what we're going to eat next week. We've already come past that, haven't we? But the Bible, God said, I'm going to feed them to the full. But isn't it a shame? Isn't it a shame that blessings very rarely bring man to God? God is good to us. God gives and gives and gives. And yet somehow or another, it is not in those good times that men are drawn to God. But it is in the bad times in our life. When there are sickness and death and the economy downturn, it is those times when of unsurety in our life that we are prone to turn to God and to trust God and to depend upon God. It seems to me like, folks, we got it backwards. When things are going good and God has blessed us in so many ways, it seems to me like that ought to give in our heart a more reverence to God than it would if things are going bad. But there's another thing about these leaders. Not only were they informed scripturally, not only were they inflated with substance, they were indecent in sexuality. Look, if you will, at verse 7. How shall I pardon thee? For their children have forsaken me and sworn by them. And let me go to verse 6 now. Verse 6 and verse 7. The verse 7 says, as a fountain cast out their waters, so shall she carry out her wickedness. Now verse 7 and verse 8 in chapter 5 talks about the indecency of it. There was a calling program years ago, and this thing of promiscual sex was just kind of in the beginning stage of society, and the program was about committing adultery. Now this lady calls in and said, well, what's the big deal? Nobody's getting killed, are they? So her concept was the only sin that God was really concerned with was the sin of murder. But listen, the Bible is concerned about all sins, all those Ten Commandments that He gave us. Not only that, they were socially indifferent to things. In other words, society has a standard within themselves set up. And these folks had so sinned, the leaders had so sinned, that they went far beyond that, far, far beyond that. So first of all, there is a corrupt leadership that creates chaos. But now there's another thing. There is a compromising preacher. Now, hats off to every man that God's ever called to preach. Everybody that has a word for the Lord is good. Everybody that God's called to preach, I thank God for them. But listen, God expects us to preach the Bible. God expects us to preach the truth of God's Word. There's three things about compromising preachers. First of all, he has a message and preaches a message that is untrue. Folks, you don't need to have itching ears. If the Bible hits you the wrong way, you need to be healed. If the Bible blesses you, then you need to be blessed by the way that you live. But you see, there's a lot of false preaching going on today. See, if a preacher tells you it's not wrong, homosexuality is not wrong, he's lying.
Amen.
Nothing to it. He is lying. If a preacher says it's all right to steal, he's lying. It is not all right to do anything that the Ten Commandments does not allow you to do. And anybody that preaches anything other than that is a liar, and that's the only way you can classify it. Now, if I was a lay person, I'd want to hear the truth. I'd want to hear the man, it might hit me, it might rub me the wrong way. Let me tell you what the truth is. The truth is, you are a sinner that was saved by grace.
Amen.
Everybody with me now? You are a sinner that was saved by grace. When you entered into the family of God by the new birth, you were born again. And as a baby must take baby steps, as a baby must be fed on baby food, so you and I started our journey with God. But folks, God don't expect you to stay a baby all your life. God expects us to grow in grace and in knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. There will come times in your life when you sin against God. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. Don't be in denial. Be in repentance. Repent from your sins and move on with God. See, that's how we grow in the Lord. That was the people's problem in Jeremiah's day. They had all these false prophets prophesying to them, and they thought everything was all right. Even in the New Testament times, this false prophecy was still going on. It had been so intense that the people of Israel thought if you were rich, then it was an indication that God was with you and you were saved because you were rich. And Jesus kind of broke that part apart by Lazarus and the rich man. See, riches and blessings have nothing to do with God's with salvation. But let me tell you, when you got saved, you may have been forgiven forever of your sins as far as redemption is concerned. But let me tell you, God holds you accountable for the sins and the wrongdoings in your life unless there's repentance. And I mean true repentance for your sins. What is repentance anyway? It is turning away. It's a military word that means about faith. It is turning from our sins and turning to God. You see, I can't go out here and commit something. I can't go out here and steal Elliot's $1 million car and say, "Lord, forgive me. Tomorrow I come back and get his own." And I say, "Lord, forgive me." Then I steal something at the store going downhill. I'm going to get a Hershey bar. And I say, "Lord, forgive me." Folks, let me tell you, that won't work. That won't work. When I talk about repentance, I'm talking about the turning plow of God running through your heart and turn all those things that's wrong in your heart upside down and bringing you back to God. That's what repentance is all about. And they had methods that were unscriptural. Notice the word he used in verse 11. He says, a priest ruled by their means. What does he mean by that? The word means is a hand. And there's two kinds of hands that this word can be. There's Yahweh, which means an open hand. There's Chaos, which means a hollowed hand. But the one here is the cowled hand. And what it means is this. When you do that, you have a cup in your hand and it will hold something. And what the prophet Jeremiah said, that the hands were like that. What's he saying? He's saying they were doing it on their own. They were not getting a message from God. They were ruling by their own means. Folks, I can't get up here and tell you what I think. It don't matter what I think. You got a right to think what you want to think. It's not my job to to get up here and just tell you what I think. They was the flip. No, I got to tell you, thus saith the Lord. This is what God said. This is what the Bible says about it. Churches all over the land, they're men's opinion. Men's opinion. No, it is what the Bible says that really, really counts. If I'm going to get ready, if I was a lay person, I was going to get ready and I was going to come to church and I was going to sit in the pew and listen, I want somebody to tell me the truth. I don't want to come and hear a lie. I want to hear what the Bible has to say. It might make me so mad I would never come back. But so what? I need to know the truth. I don't need to be whitewashed and made feel good when I'm not good in the sight of the Lord. Not only that, their motives are totally unholy. Why would I not tell the truth? If I'm going to study God's Word, why would I not tell the truth? You know why they didn't? Because they wanted to please people. Folks, I ain't worried about pleasing y'all. I don't care if I please y'all or not, to be honest with you. I don't want to be crude and rude or anything like that. But that's not it. Paul said, who do I seek to please? Do I seek to please God or men? If I seek to please men, I'm no longer the servant of God. Ain't no use me calling myself a preacher. Now, I know that we should not be harsh, should not be ugly after. You know, God, if God entrusts me with the truth, there's two ways I can use that truth. I can use it like a club, or I can use it like a pillow for, you know, rest and word here. You see, I can't be bullied even with the truth. Nathan, remember David in the Bible. Remember David in the Bible. What did he do? Big sin in his life. Committed adultery, killed him, a lady's husband. That's pretty big. Now, I don't guess over half a dozen of y'all done that, have you? So here comes Nathan the prophet. He said, David, listen, buddy, I don't want to offend you. I certainly don't want to get on your bed and say, that's not what he said. He said, but you have sinned against God. You've sinned against God. Now, here was a king. Here was a man who could have him put to death just like that, like he did the woman's husband. And the prophet is saying, you've sinned against God. You've sinned against the holy God. Now, listen, here's the result of sin. David in Psalms 51 said, Lord, restore to me the joy of my salvation. David did not lose his salvation. If you sin against God, you won't lose your salvation if you've been sinned. But I'm telling you, you will have the most miserable life, and it will set things in your life that will never, never go away.
Amen.
The prophet said, God's forgiven you, David, but the sword of God will be on your house from now on. From now on, you will suffer because of this sin. So the point is this, don't sin.
Amen.
When you do sin, get rid of it in a hurry. So what is the result? We got corrupt leaders and the national leaders, and we got corrupt preachers. So what is the result of that? When those together come together, what takes place? You have, thirdly, complacent people. People are just, you know, dragging through religion. What did they do? They put money before morals. Money before morals. Things in the world before the things of God. John Patterson, I believe John's his first name, author. He and another man a few years ago wrote a book. And in the title of that book, The Day America Told the Truth. I don't know if y'all have read that book or not. But they had to do a lot of surveying. Had to do a question of a lot of people, thousands and thousands, before they wrote the book. Here's what they found. 13% of people said the Ten Commandments are not binding. Folks, if all the Ten Commandments wasn't binding, God would not have wrote them on a rock. Why? Every single one of them is binding as long as the world stands. Jesus said, I didn't come to do away with the Ten Commandments. Where'd y'all ever get a crazy idea like that? I came to fulfill the Ten Commandments. 91% said they lied on a regular basis. Have you told a lie last week? Well, of course you have. Y'all just look back at me. 91% said we lie on a regular basis. They asked another question. What would you do for $10 million? Not $1 million, $10 million. $10 million. But $10 million. Elliot, $10 million. What would you do for $10 million? Said I'd forsake my family. 25% said I would forsake my family. I'd walk away from them. I'd leave them crying at the door. But I held my $10 million. 23% said I'd become a prostitute for a week. For $10 million. 7% said I'd kill a stranger. For no reason. I'd just shoot him or tame him or whatever. I'd kill a stranger for $10 million. Money. Anything for money. That's the way these people were. They were rich, the prophet said. But not only did they put money above morals, they put had revelation without respect. You see, if I know the Word of God, every one of us is in a learning process of the Word of God. If I know the Word of God, there puts on me a responsibility goes with me knowing the Word of God. In other words, I don't need to know it and not share. I don't need to know it and not tell what I know. You say, well, nobody's asking. Listen, you can enter into a conversation. You'd be surprised at some of the wild things people think about the Bible and how they're supposed to leave. But there's another thing they did. They sinned without shame. Sinned without shame. God holds back the wrath that's coming. But then, after a while, there comes God's wrath. You really want a revelation from really where the rubber meets the road. If you want a revelation, drive a church van. Well, full of kids. They'll tell it all. They tell it all. They told what mama said to daddy and daddy said to mama. And not only that, what mama and daddy did that they thought was wrong. They want the preacher to know what's going on. And we hear all that. Hear all that. They tell it all. But now, how do you fix it? See, to know it is one thing, but to fix it. I mean, we can sit around and shake our hands, all things are not as good as they used to be and all that, morally, and they're certainly not, that's good to be aware of it, but what do we do with it now? How do we fix it? How do we fix what's going on? What do people need to do? They need to repent of their sins and turn to God. Amen. That fixes everything. That would do. Can you imagine if everybody, well, let's say, let's don't go that extreme. Let's say if 75% of the people in the United States, whether they were lost or whether they were backslidden, simply got on their knees and repented of their sins and turned back to God. Folks, Monday morning, you think you'd live in paradise. Amen. Everything would be so different. Where does the power lie to fix society? It lies with Christian people. It lies with us. So are we supposed to blame ourselves? No, we're not supposed to blame ourselves. What we're supposed to do is just simply share the word. I can't make somebody get saved.
Right.
I can't make somebody repent. But I can tell them about Jesus. I can tell them about the Lord. I can invite them to the fellowship of the church. I'll tell you something, you'll get more people to come to church if you'll talk to them about Jesus instead of talking to them about the church. Because you see, when a man gets under conviction for his sins, and when that or when the hard times come in his life, you know where people would have a tendency to turn to? They want the church. They want to be embraced by God's people. I know every Sunday I preach and I feel like I'm preaching to the choir. And I hope y'all are now of that status, not that you can sing, but you're faithful and you're here all the time and you love the Lord. And I preach to you and we talk about sin, we talk about the world, we talk about what's outside these four walls. But now let's talk about us. Let's talk about us. How are things with us? God's people's not exempt from getting down now. You know that? It all circumstances enter into it. Boy, it's awful easy. Awful easy for the things of the world, not necessarily sinful things. Our house was flooded with a leak ice maker. Got the whole house, most of it tore apart, or did have. That preys on your mind. We face things every day that are oppressed to us. But thank God, God not only works with us through sinful things, but through things that are not sinful, that's just simply but things that oppress us, you see. And most Christian people, most church members, they're not diehard sinners. I wouldn't have a right to get up here and talk to you and treat you like you're an outlaw or drug addict or something like that. No, but y'all are good people. Y'all are God's people. And y'all have in your power the ability to change where you live and change the world. Let's pray together. Now, God, thank you for your word. Lord, I thank you for the word of God. Thank you for the illustration you give for many centuries. And yet, sin has not changed. People has not changed. It is as if Jeremiah was on 24 hours to face the nation. He addressed everything in that day. Here we are basically at the same place. God, we pray that the judgment of God will not fall on our nation, will not be carried away, or our grandchildren and children carried away to some foreign land. But Lord, we think of spirituality just as spirituality, but it affects everything. It affects our country, it affects our life. And Lord, I pray today, perhaps there's those here that need to come and just pray at the altar or rededicate your life, or whatever the need might be in their lives. God, will you bless this crowd that's gathered here today. Lord, let us be what you want us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together now and let's sing.